I am mid-game here in the first scenario for this game, and there are so many excellent how to play and playthrough videos for this fantastic solitaire war game out there that I'm not even going to attempt to do anything like that. So this video is going to be a little different than my usual. I am going to go through some basic gameplay here, but trying to keep this as short as possible for those of you that want more of a 15 to 20 minute overview of the game to make a decision about it. So let's look first of all at the framing of this game. What is the problem here? What are you trying to do in the game? As the U.S. Marines, you are entering the island on the west side here, and you've got various victory conditions, and we'll talk about the scenarios in the game in a minute. For the first two scenarios, your efforts are centered on this airfield here, ultimately, to gain control of the airfield, and in particular, for the shorter scenarios, gain control of the hexes that project fire onto the landing beach hexes. So, as you can see here in this gorgeously detailed map, there are dots. These are both colored in dots, which represents intense fire, and there are also something called, let me see if I can show it to you, here you go, a steady fire dot, and they have different implications, but nevertheless, if a hex is, a Japanese-controlled hex is projecting fire onto one of the landing beaches, one of the victory conditions ultimately is to occupy these hexes, and there are rules and clarifications for what an occupation means. The coral hexes over here to the south and actually up here on the north, control of those hexes is also part of the victory condition, as is control over the hexes labeled B in the B zone. So the initial scenarios, which look at the initial landings, here we have scenario one taking you from this time frame, 08:30, I guess, half past 8, to 1800 hours is the first scenario, and this represents just the initial landing. The time frame varies, so you've got a half an hour, this from 4 to 5 represents an hour of time. The units come in on designated turns, which is represented by this number here. So this unit, we are right now in turn 6. The first scenario is a 12-turn game, so we're really right in the middle here. This unit just came in on the prior turn, and you can see how far I progressed, for example, with this unit that came in on turn 2, and moving forward. You start to get a big diminishment in the number of units coming in after the first few turns here. On turn 7, you can see I have one unit coming in, and on 8, and then really nothing else for this scenario. The initial second scenario goes to 24 turns, so you do get some more coming in. I actually think some come in on 17, although for some reason I don't have them out here. The Japanese units are unrevealed. They are set up in pre-designated hexes, and events will cause them to be revealed during the course of the game. Additionally, events will cause them to attain a depth marker, which strengthens the unit or represents that unit at full strength, and these are triggered by card events during the course of the game. There are also Japanese reserve units here. There are 15 unknown Japanese reserve units that can also be coming in during the course of the game. Gameplay is controlled by these cards, and we'll take a look here briefly at some of the cards. Each card has potentially 12 pieces of information on it. The card is read for only one piece of information at a time as needed. So the top part of the card here, clearly indicated by landing, concerns what happens when your pre-designated units are coming in and landing, whether they are subjected to any type of step-down loss from fire that they may have upon landing, and whether they drift when landing or they just come right into where you would expect them to come. 2 to 12 refers to events that happen in turns 2 to 12. And you can see here on the turn track moving through, you have your landing phase, which is the top part of the card. And then you have your first event phase, which happens beginning on turn 2. We have separate events for also turns 14 to 23, which is the turns in the second scenario. BNR stands for Bloody Nose Ridge. That is the third scenario. I will get to that in a minute. These colors and symbols here control the Japanese units and really represent the heart of the game. They work in consort with the map. And if you're familiar with the system, first of all, you're probably not watching this video, but second of all, I'll simply say that though it looks quite complicated with all these various dots, it's really a very elegant and ultimately simple system once you understand it, that there are various rules for understanding if a color comes up on a card and you are positioned in this hex, for example, with this filled in dot representing intense fire, your unit would take a hit. And there are charts and rules that explain exactly what happens. So when you are drawing a card and reading for the Japanese fire card phase, which is the third phase of a turn, you are looking at the Japanese units in the corresponding colored hexes to see that they potentially are activated to fire, and then referring to the rules to see what type of damage they have done. So the AI is controlled in a card-based manner such as that. There is an additional piece of information on certain cards in the bottom here, which is not represented on these cards, and that refers to an artillery fire that your units can have be subjected to even before they land. So if that comes up on a card, you could be affected even before you land. This is a constrained area. Obviously, it is an island and it's an invasion scenario. You're really working on different portions of the map for different scenarios. Most of the action for certainly the first scenario in 12 turns is concerned here on the western side of the map, moving forward and trying to control these hexes here to ultimately gain control of this airport. The third scenario concerns this mountain range here and only takes place in this mountain range here. It brings in other actions on the Japanese part and intense fire really from the beginning of the scenario, which when you start that scenario, you, I will show you the setup for it, but you're already in this mountain range dealing with the cave structure that had been established. It was really used as a fortress by the Japanese, and the rules of that scenario reflect it. It's such a different scenario from the first two that it comes with its own player aid card and its own set of rules, and one of them you saw was here, that it has its own individual events that happen for that scenario alone. The last piece of information I'll mention here is CC event. That stands for close combat, and I am going to take you through a close combat example, really my only extended example of gameplay for this video, to show you how it works. So we'll look at that next. Well, in the interest of time, I've decided not to take you through details on the third scenario, the scenario that's played here in the mountains outlined, but I will simply tell you that it brings in different actions, as I said, for the Japanese, and it also gives the U.S. some of the actions immediately that in the other scenarios it takes a while to get, chiefly having HQ command, whereby you have an HQ unit that will have a command range and provide other actions for units. So, for example, taking back a look at this game that we have set up here, this unit has a command radius that will enable a quote-unquote free action to occur for units within its command radius. In the other scenario, you have that right away, and it represents more of a really close combat scenario, intense fire, as I said from the beginning, fortifications that the Japanese can build in the mountains, etc. Historically, it is very accurate in terms of what happened in this battle, and it has a very different feel of play from the first two scenarios. Moving back to what I was saying about HQ, I want to just make a couple of points about why this game is so successful. You are given two actions per turn, just two, to do unless you position yourself to use what can be deemed free actions, which is to say actions that do not count against your two. One of a number of free actions you can have concerns how you position your HQ units. What this means is that during the course of this game, you're already feeling constrained, of course, because you're playing in a geographically constrained area, and you find that you are coming into a bottleneck situation here down by the southern portion of the island, trying to travel here. You can travel through this light water hex, I'm pretty sure, but to try to travel here to occupy these coral areas, and again occupy the hexes projecting fire onto the beaches. It feels very tight when you're playing, and that is one of the excellent modeling effects of this game. The tension, the fact that you are really always feeling like you have more to do than you can, and this extends sometimes even to your landings, because there is a stacking limit of two per hex. The HQs are excluded from that unit, that limit, but there's a stacking limit of two, so what can happen even is that you are unable to bring in some of your units when you would want to. This is just one of the numerous ways that you are faced with difficult choices about what to do, whether to attack, whether to do what's known as a barrage attack, which is in effect for a Japanese unit that has already been revealed, a sense throwing caution to the wind and just going with the luck of the draw, literally, pulling up a card and seeing if you can get a match which would impact the Japanese unit. So there is an excellent combination of being forced to plan, being unable to plan, really, because of the random nature of the card draw and not knowing which Japanese units will be activated on any given turn and which will be able to disrupt you or cause you to lose a step or indeed be eliminated, and forcing you to keep in mind the short-term goals of moving inward on the island, the longer-term goals of positioning your HQ units so that later in the game, you are able to turn your HQ units, if you have them, into command posts. And if you do this effectively, each turn that you have command posts established, you move this command post marker that I don't actually have out here up to show the range of that your command post is extended. So if you have a command post set up, which I don't have here, but this, for example, is the type of HQ unit that could turn into one, the longer I have it established, the wider its range gets, and units within this range are fall into the free action category. So you can do more and more, but you have to be properly positioned. And that is a long-term goal you need to keep in mind. Overall, finally, to keep this video short, as I said, the fact of the cards working so effectively, and really the genius of the design of controlling an artificial intelligence game play with cards, is seamless. It feels natural. It feels as if you are playing against a player, and it feels as if every game differs. Even though the setup is the same for every game, the units are coming in on the same hexes. The units are random, so you don't know how strong or weak they are. The tanks, too. There are four Japanese tanks coming in initially on the same hexes. You don't know how strong or weak they are. even with that sameness of the setup, each game feels different because of the randomness of the cards. Overall, this is a game that requires some effort to learn if you don't know the system. And if you are new to war games, it will be a challenge. I think it is heartily worth putting in the effort for those of you interested in the time period and certainly those of you interested in solo gameplay. For our close combat example, we're going to take a look here at this blue hex, and we've got our HQ here and this artillery that are going to enter this hex and do close combat. I'll just show you how that works. So the first thing to do with this unrevealed depth marker is you reveal it, and then you are distributing cards. So for the US, you're going to draw, here we are with the US, we've got six steps. First, we're going to draw one card for each step up to a maximum of four cards. So that would give us four cards for that. And then we would get additional cards if we had a flamethrower present, which we do not, if we have a US hero, which we do not, or if the Japanese are in counterattack stance, which they are not. So we've got then a total of four cards for the US. Coming back then, we are drawing cards for the Japanese, and we will get one card for each unit and one card for each depth marker, so that's a total of two. And additionally, we get one card if for every close combat requirement on the counter. So we have one close combat requirement, so that's a third card. We would potentially get more cards if the Japanese strength was greater than or equal to four, which it is not. We would also get if they were in jungle, karl, or mountain terrain, which they are not. This is brush and beach. And I think that is it. So the Japanese then are getting a total of three cards. So we've got four US and three Japanese. So now we start with the card reveal. We start with the Japanese side. We turn over their card. We look for something that says CC, close combat event, and there is none. So there's nothing to do there. And then we look down at the colors here. And if we see we are having close combat in a blue hex, had we seen a blue hex here, that's what we're looking for, really, we would have had to remove a step from the US side. We do not, so we discard that card, and then we move over to the US side, flip over the first US card, again checking for the close combat, any close combat event. There is one here, and that is heroism. And heroism instructs us, we get to add a card to the pile of the side that revealed it. So we get a card, and we also get to remove a card from the card pile of the other side. So that's great. So we are going to take away this Japanese card, and I guess we'll just discard it there, and we get to add a card. It doesn't really tell us where to put it. I'm gonna put it at the bottom of our stack. So now we are definitely, they're only having one card left at this point. So we note now that the position color of this hex has appeared on the US card, which means we get to remove another Japanese card. So they're down to no cards. And the other thing we get to do per the rules at this point is to place a disrupted marker on the unit. So we will do that. Remembering here, this is all taking place in this hex here. So now the Japanese are both disrupted and have no cards left. We continue to reveal our cards. So we're going to discard this card, and we will start revealing the next card. Again, we're looking for blue, which here we go again. I did not set this up for the game. Honestly, I didn't. Or I should say for the video. I just set it up for the game, random. So we are getting another blue on the US card, and what this means is that we get to, let's see, they are disrupted already, so now we get to remove this depth marker. So we're going to do that. So we're down to the unit and the disruption. Again, no Japanese cards. We get to continue to reveal another blue. So now Let's see, we've got disrupted and no depth marker present, so the unit is finally eliminated. And we have successfully eliminated that unit. We didn't actually even need, we're still left with two cards. The rules, unless I'm mistaken, don't really instruct you what to do. If I haven't revealed these cards, I just basically put them back on my draw pile. So there you have it, a close combat example. It occurs to me I should show you this player aid card for the close combat procedure because, first of all, it's an example of the player aid cards with this game are all very clear and make the procedures unambiguous as to what you should do. But the reason I want to show it to you is because though that close combat did end with the defeat of the Japanese, honestly, most of the time that doesn't exactly happen. So I just want to show you here some of the other options. As mentioned, if the units are all eliminated, the survivors are going to remain in the hex. Disrupted is one of the ways that it might end. If both players' card piles are used up, then that is ending by exhaustion. Then the units would be disrupted and the surviving attacking units would go to the hex position. The U.S. could withdraw as well under fire. So there are different options than I showed here. And the close combat events, we saw the heroism one, but there are other ones that happen, including what seems to happen to me most is reinforce, which is the Japanese get to add to their card pile, although in this example we happen to draw heroism. So the ending of that close combat would be with the elimination and the disruption on the U.S. Again, in the interest of time, I'm now just going to talk about a few other points without showing you anything on the map, but I do want to make these points about the ways in which certain aspects of this game have been abstracted to highlight the gameplay and make things run smoothly. When the U.S. attacks, there's a U.S. attack results chart. Now, I showed you the close combat, but you can also attack from an adjacent hex. And the way this works is quite clever because you are not only involving the strength of the attacking unit and the strength of the defending unit, but you also need to have the appropriate weaponry to attack. And in some cases, you won't know that if you're attacking an unrevealed unit because the Japanese units will indicate what weaponry is required for a successful attack. And when you look on the attack results chart, which is basically like a CRT, although there, you know, there's no dice in this game and there's no actual CRT, the first thing you need to do is say yes or no, do you possess the required weapons? And if you do, you move along that chart and then consider your strength versus the Japanese strength and come to a section on that chart and then continue to move along for the result, whether you are attacking a Japanese unit alone or one with an either revealed or unrevealed depth marker. The same thing is true if you don't have the weaponry, you're following along a different row of this chart to determine how successful or not you are. This becomes extremely effective, I think, in being a shorthand way of modeling whether or not an attack can be successful and how an attack, no matter how well set up you might be in terms of your own strength, can fail if you don't have, for example, the right weapons. The various attack results are pretty much what you would expect. You can become disrupted yourself. You can cause the Japanese to gain a depth marker, which is to say to become stronger. They can become disrupted. Other things like that can happen. But the combat there is very effectively handled. The other thing I want to say that is an excellent facet of this game, also I failed to point this out, but on the turn chart, there is, beginning at turn 5, I think, something called a catastrophic loss number. What this means is that if you have lost that many or more U.S. units during that turn, you will automatically lose the game. So this is kind of a check on too much reckless behavior, perhaps, because if you are facing, for example, the knowledge that with a 12-unit loss, you automatically lose the game, and you've already lost, you know, 10 units, you may act more cautiously in the coming turns. So this is yet another way, another constraint of the game that makes it play very smoothly and is a clever way of abstracting the complexities of actual combat. The last thing I'll say on that point concerns the Japanese additional firing capacities that happen during the course of the turn. Again, I didn't particularly point this out in when I was giving you the overview of the map, and now I've put it away, but there were some numbered counters, or excuse me, lettered counters, A, M, R, that come in on different turns as the scenarios progress. What these represent are additional Japanese actions that can be taken, whether it's mortar fire represented, for example, by the M, or redeployment or resupply or reinforcement represented by the R. There's a patrol action. These are all explained in the rules, and they add a degree of extra contours, really, is how I would describe it, to the combat as the game progresses, as you would expect. As your presence on this island has been longer, the Japanese are more aware of you. They are going to be planning ambushes and doing patrols and bringing in reinforcements. And on the designated turn, they will be allowed to do that with their activated units if the card that you pull has that letter on the card in a particular color. So if you pull a card and there's a purple square with a P on it, it means that any activated purple unit can also do a patrol action. Again, one of the many ways in which this brilliant solitaire design by John Butterfield absolutely shines in terms of making it feel as if you're playing a live opponent, as if the game is changing as time passes, becoming more complex, and also as you play the game multiple times, you have in the back of your mind the knowledge of what is to come, and that does impact your planning and your desire to position yourself as effectively as possible in the early turns of the game. Let's take a quick look at the components here and do an assessment, starting with the counters. To me, I'd say the counters are certainly, they're adequate. They're not particularly thick. I do wonder and worry about their durability over time, because if you're somebody like me who's not using tweezers to play the game, you're certainly doing a lot of moving around of the counters. And because you're working with counters that come in on particular turns, so for example here, if we can focus, we're looking at this number two here. This is the counters that come in on turn two. You know, if you're playing this game and you're losing a lot in the first few turns, you're going to be handling the same counters over and over again. And I do wonder a little bit about that. They are clearly printed, as you can see, basic information that is adequate and necessary. I would have liked to see, here's an HQ unit designated by the star, and of course it says HQ here. For my purposes, I would have liked to see the HQ with a little bit more of different coloration, so that scanning the map, I could easily see where my HQs are. It's done nicely here for the reduced counters. So, for example, if you're stepping down from a four unit to a three, you flip that over, and then when you go from three to two, this would be this unit, and then to one. So the step-down unit is clearly indicated with the bright green band. I would have liked something similar, or similar in the sense of a different coloration for the HQ. Ditto the disruption counters here. We'll take a look at, this is the Allied, the Japanese disruption, and they're meant to have different colors because there are different ways, for example, that the Allies can be disrupted. Again, for me, that's a little similar. I just ended up not even using that aspect of the game. It was too confusing for me. What I did use that was quite helpful These action under fire and attack orders that are meant to be chits used in the Bloody Nose Ridge scenario, I actually use them differently. I flip them over here and use them to indicate actions taken, free actions taken, so I didn't get confused and inadvertently conduct two actions with one counter, which you're not supposed to do. The other thing, obviously, that gets a lot of wear and tear in this game are the cards. You are using them at all times for every turn and getting going through the deck, you know, a couple times, two, three times per game for the shorter scenarios, at least. They 100% need to be sleeved. I mean, the quality is, you know, even if you weren't using the, even if it wasn't such a card-heavy play, I think you can sort of see here, it's really not that heavily laminated and not that thick. So really just about adequate on the quality of the cards. 100%, you're going to have to sleeve these cards. The map, I would say, is, now I've got it under plexiglass here because I'm still in the middle of playing, but I will say that the map quality is excellent. It is a little bit thicker paper map than some other, I would say, than the average game. Let me see if I can just sort of pull it out here a little bit. Show you there. It's a nice quality thickness. Nevertheless, I would recommend putting it under some plexiglass. You can see the clarity here. This is not under the plastic of the print job. And it's important because you're really looking at the colors, and the colors have to match up quite clearly. Some of them are, you know, the browns and the yellows, fairly close in palette. But sorry about that there. As I was saying, these need to match up with the cards, and really for the most part they do. I found one card here that has more of an orange than a yellow, but basically there's clarity of the color matching. And lastly, there are the player aid cards, which are very clear in terms of the information on them. Again, to me, disappointing in terms of the quality. This is, it's just a really thin, you know, it's cardboard-ish, I guess, thicker than the regular paper, but it's not a great quality. I think that we could have been better served there on it. The rules booklet is quite nicely printed. The color, the illustrations, the rules themselves, very clear. It's a complicated game, but I think the rule book does an excellent job of explaining it. And despite the fact that there is not a proper index, for the most part, because the table of contents is so detailed, I was able to find most things that I was looking for when I needed to look them up. There, you know, I would have appreciated an index, for example, looking up the garrison markers here. This was something actually I did need to look up the placement of them. It took me a little while to figure out that they had put it here as opposed to elsewhere. But for the most part, the rule book is quite nicely done. And here are the design credits from the rules. Interestingly, unless I'm missing it, certainly not on the front of the box. On the back of the box, we have another great solitaire game from John Butterfield, designer of D-Date, Omaha Beach, and Tarawa, and RAF. Indeed, it is another great solitaire game. It plays, well, they list 1 to 2. I have actually played part of a game, at least, with a friend who helped me make some decisions there. It's a solo game. I mean, it's really designed as solo. Playing time 2 to 8 hours. Yeah, I would say that's pretty accurate. Medium complexity. Yes, medium to a solidly medium game, let's say that. There are a lot of details. Certainly, if you know the system from the prior games in the series, there are some new things here, but it will be very familiar to you. If you're fresh to the system, as I said, prepare to put in some time, but ultimately it's a medium game with fairly clear rules and obviously solitaire value quite high. So there you have it. Excellent, excellent solo game from Decision Games and John Butterfield.